Thank you so much for coming. If I haven't already given you a kind of goldenrod colored feedback sheet and or a copy of tonight's candidate's resumes, just please do the signal along and try to run it right over to you. The first candidate you'll be hearing from tonight is Peter Light, the assistant superintendent of Franklin. And we'll let him start off by telling you a little bit about himself, and then feel free to ask any questions that that come to your mind. He's got about 45 minutes. All set? Do you think you need this? I know that I don't.
As long as no one else can you all hear me okay? I much prefer to speak without a microphone. So first, thank you for coming out tonight. I'll tell you how you spent the day here in Washington, and really confirmed all of my outside perspective on Washington. It's really wonderful. People I've met with today, from teachers to students, to some of the administrative team and some of the parents.
Yeah, sort of.
A little bit about my background. I have been in Franklin for the last 20 years of my career, so to speak. And I don't take the thought of being a community like I've built up a lot of relationships over time that we may have to leverage to support. We have to use the microphone for that. I had a feeling coming. Thought I'd avoid it as long as possible.
Start. I'm going to save you all from starting fresh, but it's been a wonderful career I've been able to have in Franklin as the high school principal and now as the assistant superintendent most recently, but also as a teacher coming up in the system there, and it gave me a lot of perspective on different roles within the system. Over time, for me, I've developed really three fundamental beliefs that I use in my work daily that I hope to bring to Hopkinton, and these are values that I've long held, but as I look at the Hopkinton website, I've talked to some people to test out my thinking around core values. I think that my beliefs really align well with Hopkinton. My first belief that I really believe the foundation of everything we do in the center of all of our relationships is the concept of trust and accountability, that they work interchangeably and they're simultaneous with each other. That when you build a sense of trust, you're also building in that sense of accountability, which breeds transparency as well. I believe that whether you're working with parents, or you're working with community, or you're working with your faculty, students, and your administrative team, it really has to start with that concept of trust and that mutual accountability to each other. So that's one of my three core values that I hold. A second one is achievement through innovation. If you look at the work that I've done in my career through Franklin, I think we have really had an opportunity to leverage some strengths of our community, use innovative programming for students. A few that I'll talk about, we developed an arts academy at our high school as a way of making our curriculum more relevant and interdisciplinary for students who have a passion in the arts. That then led into an opportunity to rethink how we did science education at the high school level. And currently I'm working on social and emotional learning with the district in Franklin. I think all three have a lot of impact on students, and it's been an exciting opportunity to be able to do that. So that's that idea that we achieve through innovation, and we're constantly looking for kind of our next thoughts as a school community. The third core value I have is equity. I come from a family. I have some relatives with some significant disabilities. I also was fortunate enough that when I was growing up, I actually started my school years in another country. I grew up in Panama, I started schooling in Panama. And then we had moved back to the United States just after my kindergarten year. And it was very interesting because when I came back, I experienced coming from a bilingual background myself because I grew up also speaking Spanish. And when I came back to the United States, I really felt that lens from my friends around me that it was not okay to have that background. And so as I've developed in my career, I really think that one of the goals we have as educators is to make sure that our schools are responsive to each student who comes through the doors every day, and each family who comes through the doors as well. So the idea of trust, accountability, equity, and also achievement and innovation are really three ideas. As I looked for communities that I may be interested in working in, Hopkinton truly stood out to me. I have worked in this region my entire career. I live relatively close. I live in Walpole, Massachusetts. And I have two young children myself in middle school and elementary school. And I think that, to me, looking at a district I would like to lead, it needs to be the type of a district that I would also love to raise a family in. And I think Hopkinton is one of those places. In preparation for kind of my initial interview and thinking, trying to make my decisions around deciding to apply to Hopkinton, one of the things I did was watch the school committee meetings to get a sense of what the district is working on. And one of the more challenging topics that I saw brought up and discussed was the idea of elementary school busing and trying to provide parents with an opportunity to bring their children to different daycare programs after school. And it wasn't so much the issue that interested me about the community, but what cemented for me that this was a rich community to be able to apply to was the degree to which the discussion remained respectful, regardless of the diverse opinions expressed on the issue. And as I saw parent after parent after parent, I watched three or four parents speak, it all started with, we so value the feedback from the administrators, and we understand the perspective they're coming from, but we also want to share our perspective on what it's like to raise family in 2018. The pressures on parents are different, our employment is different, and we lean on people to visit each and every event. We work in different locations, we're not always in town, and this is something that we count on to be able to help us raise family. Needs for us. And again, it really wasn't the issue, but it was the way that the discussion unfolded, both from the school committee, the administration, and the parents who spoke that night, that really made me feel like this is a respectful environment, one that values its schools. It can also tackle some tough, difficult conversations in just a positive, proactive, respectful manner. So I'm happy to be with you tonight, and I hope that I can answer some of your questions for you. I'll start on the left. Maybe what I'll do is I'll start on the left, I'll work my way to the right, and then we'll do that again. Kind of four. Sure. So I spent 8 years as a high school principal, and what I came to appreciate during my time was really focusing on leadership development. I think it's a critical aspect of either a building principal or a district administrator. And that was probably my area where I had the most passion for, was in developing leaders. I think one of the most prideful things about my time there was the number of assistant principals who have gone on to become principals in other communities. And I transitioned into the central office role, and it's been great because one of the things that I love doing is being able to get out into buildings and talk with principals and then visit classrooms with them. So I spent, I think over the course of last year, I visited each of our 11 schools, probably on average about 10 times. And the format that I used for those meetings was to meet the principal privately for about an hour, and we discussed the problem of practice, brainstorming problems and solutions that they're grappling with in their daily work. And then we would go out and walk classrooms, talk about teaching and learning, talk with some kids, really just, you know, kind of get to see what's really happening in the classrooms as a way of calibrating expectations and developing ourselves professionally. That was what I enjoyed the most. I think that me looking at the types of things I enjoy, the bulk of the work that I enjoy the most is really focusing on values and values of the community and values of the district and moving those forward in education. And I think that the work the superintendent does has an opportunity to really have that deep impact. Values-based education, on making that real impact, not only in some areas that I'm focusing on social emotional learning right now, but that doesn't mean I also don't also like to have a greater impact on curriculum instruction, culture of the district. I think it's just a great opportunity. So the question, in case anyone did not hear, was when working with individuals who may not have diverse cultural backgrounds, how do you make the culture of the environment truly value inclusivity and diversity? Is that a fair summary? Sure. So in my district, over the last year or so, we've actually really struggled with some issues around diversity and inclusivity. We have always prided ourselves on being an inclusive environment, and I think what we saw coming out of society were some issues that were creeping up on us that had been probably bubbling under the surface, but now all of a sudden we're rising to a level where we were really just experiencing some things we didn't think we anticipated. Part of my role in the district is the civil rights coordinator, and so we did a couple things as an administrative team. One, if you look at our district improvement plan, and frankly, you can see inclusivity is in all four of our major district goals and strategic objectives. That was incredibly important to us to focus on an inclusive environment, and I think putting it forefront of the district strategic plans is a start in that direction. We have also done some other things. We, in our middle level, we have chosen to partner with the Anti-Defamation League, and we're bringing in a program called The World of Difference. And currently, we're training all of our seventh graders in across the district in all three middle schools, and they will be delivering lessons on inclusivity and diversity to the rest of that middle school community through the rest of this year. That same plan is in effect for the high school for next year, that we're moving that up to the high school. We're also taking an opportunity to look at literature across the district and the types of literature we're using to enrich students' lives in their daily reading, because I think the more we can embed the key concepts and values that we want to teach in the literature kids are exposed to, the more that it becomes kind of a natural flow. I think equally important though, we've really taken a strong stand on making sure that we follow the investigative complaints, and that we're looking at all of our processes and procedures to make sure that if someone raises a concern to us, that they, you know, we take some really important steps to validate that we appreciate their concern coming forward, and also respond to people in writing to make sure that they know the outcome of any investigation we do. We also, one of the pieces of work that I'm more proud of over the course of the summer, I met with our administrative team a number of times, and it was great people came back from vacation to do this work because they felt it was so important. And we used a resource from the Southern Poverty Law Center on bias in schools and strategies schools can use to respond quickly to hate incidents, because we were starting to see some incidents pop up across our district. And we developed a set of administrative protocols for how we wanted to respond to hate incidents. And that included everything from preventative measures and school cultural norms, all the way through how we would respond and make sure that we publicly denounced issues. And that as an administrative team, we were taking the strongest stand, because I think as a district administrator, as a school administrator, we can never underplay that people are watching us to see how we're going to react to those issues, and how we react sends a strong message to every person watching about how much we value them and their piece of this school. So I hope that sums up that answer. It's kind of a broad approach, but everything from a curricular approach to a responsive approach to really just having a lot of conversations with people. Yes. That's going to vary from community to community. And so just in case anyone didn't hear the question, I'll repeat it. Maybe my experience working, particularly in special education, with implementing programs to meet a wide variety of needs. I'll talk a little bit about my experience in high school. I'll talk a little bit about my experience at the district level. I have been fortunate enough to have a few different special ed directors with whom I've worked, who have all been very, very strong special education directors. When I was at the high school, we actually implemented a full co-teaching program. What we saw in looking at our students was that we were pulling students out of curriculum to a large extent and teaching students solely as special educators, as opposed to pairing special educators and content experts together. I think it's so important that the students with the highest level of need have access to the teachers with the highest level of expertise. And I think it has to start there. We all know that the number one driver of student performance and student achievement is the quality of the teacher in the classroom in front of the student. So we worked really hard to implement the full co-teaching model, and it took us about 18 months of planning and 3 years of ongoing professional development to get where we are now. But I would say probably about 98% of our course requests through special education are actually in a co-taught environment. However, simultaneously, we've developed a whole series of programs to meet a variety of needs. So for example, we have a program that focuses on social emotional needs. We have a program that's more of an alternative program for students who may just feel like a large high school of 1,800 students isn't a fit for them. We also have a program for students with more cognitive disabilities. And then we have a lot of supports in place for students on the autism spectrum disorder. So, and what we've found that just because a student has a disability doesn't mean that they're similar to any other student with a disability. We all know that each student is an individual. And I think what we're settling into now is that when we mix and match the various supports that are available to students, so some students may need to be connected to the program, but maybe in a co-taught mathematics environment. But for social emotional needs, they need to pull out of that regular environment and work directly with an adjustment counselor or an adjustment counselor pair with a special educator. So it's about thinking creatively about the profile of the student you're working with, and then making sure your district can support the various needs of students. At the elementary level, we're very fortunate that we also have a K-12 continuum to our social emotional program in Franklin, and that was something that our special education director really took a lead on, and I'm involved with because I coordinate social emotional learning in the district. And then we also have another school with a language-based program that serves students across the district, and then we also have a program for students with cognitive disabilities. I think some of that lends itself to the size of the district that we're coming from. Because we do have a larger cohort of students, it's a little bit easier to move students into some programs that support their needs. I would say, as a philosophy though, my first preference is heterogeneous environment for students, because I think that's what gives them access to rich curriculum. When we talked about co-teaching, I remember going into English classrooms and looking at really highly effective co-teaching. And what you saw was all students reading Shakespeare. But when the English teacher grouped them out, you had one group of students, or two groups of students, reading the original version of Shakespeare. Another group of students were reading a version of Shakespeare that the English teacher had actually rewritten using the vocabulary that those students could access. And then a third group of students was watching a video online of the same play, but in a redacted version. So the benefit of that is all kids had the exposure to the rich literature. They all had the exposure to the classroom environment. They all had exposure to the discussions that took place around that, but how they accessed the curriculum was vastly different based on their disabilities or what their individual needs were. So I think it's an area that I've been passionate about over my time, is making sure that all our kids have access to curriculum where they need it. Sure. Yes? So just the question again was, can talk about any of my background in working with the schools and community about bridging the gap between expectations, between community expectation of budget and the school expectation of budget. In my community, I am fortunate enough to come from a community that is in about the top 15% of school districts in terms of performance around the state, but we are in the bottom, I think, 5% of funding across the state. So we have to make a lot of creative choices about the types of programs that we are able to implement. And we have to do it very fiscally responsibly. I think one of the major releases that came out of community, Franklin was included on a national study for the highest return on investment in education. And it's really a double-edged sword to be on that list, because to get on the list, you have to have high performance, but also to get on the list, you have to really not spend money on education. And I think, our approach through the budget process has been to make that, the budget process and the development of it, a story, about what we want for our students. I think, you know, a budget that is solely based on numbers does little to engage people in wanting to support schools, but a budget where your drivers of your budget are intimately tied to the performance of your students and the achievement of your schools tells a story that people can get behind in supporting that. That's where we've been most successful. When I took over as principal at the high school in Franklin, we knew in the back of our minds that we had a building project coming on the horizon, and we were going to be asking the community to give us a lot of money toward that. And the first strategy we had was to make sure that people trusted our decision making, trusted that we were fiscally responsible in allocating resources, that we weren't hiding money, and we were taking care of the money that was given to us. And we spent probably the better part of the first 3 years of my time there just building up the trust of the community to make sure that when we went to bat to advocate for the needs of the schools, we had the support of the community behind us. At that point, when we needed the resources, we did a lot of community outreach around that. We had a number of information events at the high school about really showing people firsthand what happened in the schools. And I think when we come up on tough budget times in communities, we have to be ultra transparent with the community about our priorities, about why we are asking for resources that go beyond, maybe beyond what a community's ability to fund is, because that's really not an easy decision. I think everyone comes to the community looking for something a little bit different. I can tell you the number one thing that has never worked for us is to think that the needs of the schools are greater than the needs of any other organization in the community. And I know at times when that has kind of come about as a strategy, it's failed each and every time. Because I think what I've found is a unified front on the part of the community, and making sure that the school superintendent can work with other community leaders to develop consensus around the budget moving forward, you end up with a much more powerful message. Kind of answers that.
It answered it from the community standpoint, but I was also interested in how you work with town officials, because there is always a dichotomy between the administration and the town officials and crafting a budget. So I just kind of lost the question.
Sure. We work with our town officials very, very closely. We're fortunate in that our offices are actually co-located, so if I open up the door, you know, right outside of my office, I'm now in the town administrator's office, or the town administrator's office. So, you know, we probably talk 5 and 6 times a week on average about where we're headed with budget. And we start the process very early. It would be later than what Hopkinton does, because we're a support city form of government, so slightly different timelines. But there's a lot of communication back and forth about some of the drivers. We work hard around our insurance advisory group, because health insurance has become one of the great drivers of the school budget. When you start to see numbers looking at 16% increases in the school year, that's certainly not a sustainable number for a district or a community. So, you know, we work extensively with the town to work to negotiate health insurance on an annual basis so that we can get the best rate and provide the highest level of service to our employees. I think, you know, we also work with the town in terms of planning capital resources and monies that can be moved outside of our operating budget into capital. I think in my community, fortunately, because the funding has been so tight in recent years, we've actually moved a number of our traditional operating expenses into capital, textbook adoptions, things like that. It's not necessarily something that I think is a great recommendation I would bring forward, but it's something that we've had to do to be able to survive and put our money where personnel is, because personnel is going to be 80% plus of any school district's budget. And, you know, my firm belief is that that has to be really protected at all costs. If you don't have the right teachers in classrooms, then, you know, very little is moving forward. So hopefully that's a little bit more detail for you. Yes.
Two questions. One is a question about the biggest surprise last time I was going to assistance
assistant superintendent. Well, I work on residency in the district, which is really, in any district, it's not the most enjoyable jobs. I'm the person that registers everyone in the district when they come in, not sort of the face of everyone, but I'm kind of the person that has to say, no, maybe you're not living in the community you thought you were. I didn't expect the amount of pushback with the residency in our community, and that's really a challenge, but you know, I think, in all honesty, I was really fortunate that throughout my time as principal, I had a great mentor as a superintendent, and she involved me in many, many district relationships. So I had been on contract negotiating teams as a principal. I had led some contract negotiating teams around education evaluation while I was a principal, and so I maybe don't feel as though I was as much surprised by my role as when I actually stepped into it. I think I had a pretty good sense of what was expected of me. I think what I've enjoyed most about the transition into the role is getting to spend time in all of the classrooms in the district and not just focusing on one level. I think gaining that concept of a, you know, pre-K through 12 perspective is so integral to understanding how kids develop. And really, I think what actually, you know what surprised me the most is that good teaching at any level looks the same. It was, I expected that going into elementary schools, I'd be a little taken back by, you know, the difference in teaching that I saw from high school. And what surprises me is that I'm able to go into any elementary school walk through the principals, and we're having the exact same conversation that we've had with the assistant principals and department heads in high school. So I think the universality of good teaching practice and how it responds to kids is probably the most pleasant to class. So I'm sorry, it took me a minute to come back to that.
So when you're the assistant right now, what do you think about how you can be the superintendent?
Building the culture of the district. So I am a firm believer that everything you do is driven by your culture. And as a leader, you cannot be everywhere and make every decision, nor is it appropriate for a leader to make every decision. And what you're really doing is you're developing people around you to be able to make decisions that are the best for kids. And that takes a tremendous culture to make sure that you have an administrative team and then a teaching staff that's all on the same page and understands the vision of what you're trying to achieve, and that you understand your own core values and your own beliefs, and that you can develop those with a really high degree of consistency, so that regardless of who someone interfaces with in this district, they're receiving a consistent experience with a core set of values that is widely understood among parents, among students, and among professionals. And I think, you know, I think that we have not done surveys of teachers per se. That's a pretty complex issue in education. What we tried to do is actually build a culture where our teachers survey kids about their experiences in their own classrooms and then use that data to be able to improve their own instruction. It's a little bit different, but what we found is by building the culture that way, teachers weren't afraid of the feedback that they were receiving. I think a lot of times teachers fear feedback from a source, as we all do sometimes. That, you know, feedback isn't always a gift. But I think when we started having teachers who felt comfortable surveying the kids, what we found is the teachers were actually bringing that data into us as evaluators, and we would talk about that through rituals and process of what they were trying to work. And I think that becomes much more powerful because then the teachers actually have the opportunity to use that targeted feedback to improve it. Sure, so I have not specifically taught elementary school, but my time as the director of music was actually a K-12 experience. So I did have a lot of experience there, and in all honesty, I recognize that when using this role as one of my weaknesses. So I actually prioritized my time in the elementary schools, but I also took some time, and one of the more enjoyable things I ever did was I actually teamed up with one of our fourth grade teachers in the district, and I taught with her. As the assistant superintendent, I went into the class, I spent the day with her, really so that I could understand her kids, but I could also understand the routines and what her day looked like. It was probably the best experience I've ever had. I went home tired and fatigued at the end of the day. But it's certainly an area, you know, none of us can have a truly broad experience. We've experienced a little bit of everything. But I think it's something that certainly I've been committed to taking the steps as an assistant superintendent around that experience.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
And the second question is, what is
No, it's definitely different. And we, frankly, is a city form of government, and which means that we have a town council that approves the budget. And that's probably one of the biggest drivers, because that happens for capital budget as well as for our operating budget annually. It's not something that then gets brought to all the citizens in the town meeting format. The community I live in is a town meeting format, so I have a little bit more experience with that on that side. I think there were similar steps, though, that we go through in those processes, where it's still a budget that was adopted by the school committee initially, and then, frankly, we still bring it to recall the finance committee. I think you have on the appropriations committee here in Hopkinton. So, similar process there. I think we're then bringing it to our town council. The only thing that's missing in the city form of government is they go to the voters with that, which I think can go both ways. In all honesty, I think if you can make your case transparently with voters for your needs, I think you have some power that you're going out to all of your citizens and you're able to talk to them directly about your needs, as opposed to having, you know, nine individuals who are deciding on the kind of fate of the community. And we're fortunate that we have a fantastic relationship with our town council and with our town administrator in Franklin. So we don't really experience a lot of controversy around our budget adoption process, but I know in some communities that can really be the case.
Can I just follow that? If you did find that you had difficulty communicating, and I totally appreciate the transparency that you're suggesting that option, what if you were dealing with an administration or town manager or whatever, your appropriation committee that was not as transparent or as easy to deal with?
You know, I think there's possible tremendous power in the documents that you create and the presentations you give through your school committee meetings. You know, school committee meetings, they're the board that ultimately has the responsibility for making those decisions and has the authority to do so. But what you choose to present, how you choose to present at those meetings can go a long way to really getting the message directly out to people. You know, we have long tried to develop our budget as a story, but then we also put the line items right up there for everyone to be able to see what the money is going. And I just think that's really an important step in the process. So I think that maybe speaks a little bit to what you're talking about, but I think that's just good practice anyway. So I don't think it's something you can necessarily hedge against the difficult group, but it's just good practice to be there. Appropriate to come back over here and look at Camille. Yes.
Can you talk about the role as you probably a principal in the central office solving major problems? So how did you give an example of the process of doing central office and driving the problem and then how to potential solution for the consensus?
Sure. Trying to think of maybe some jury involved. I'm going to talk about an experience that we had in Franklin. As I talked about diversity in the community becoming an issue, that we've seen some issues of bias popping up in our community, even to the level of, you know, hate issues and hate symbols on our school property. We had a series of issues over the course of last year that kind of really shook us to the core as an administrative team, as school district, where we had some swastikas drawn on all three of our elementary and middle school complexes, and they were public, people saw them, it was a popular community, we had responded to them in the moment, and you know, we were looking for kind of a stronger way to communicate a positive value back out of that to our school communities about what we wanted. And we had put some signs up in the community that kind of that was part of a national non-political organization. But what we maybe failed to see in that was there was a very political organization within town that was protesting another political organization in town. And at some of these demonstrations, they were using those signs. And so even though the signs had been developed as a nonpartisan, non-political affiliated group, it had a perception within some of our community that was very strongly politically affiliated. And that became a really challenging issue in the community, and we ended up taking the signs down. That was really the beginning of the issue, because when we did that, and we kind of really needed to respond to some other issues that were going on, which I didn't necessarily get into all the minutiae, but it caused a lot of ripples within our own team culturally, and kind of feelings about how do we expose the values that we say we have if we're not able to publicly demonstrate what we really want for our kids. And we have to have quite a few internal discussions with some administrators about their feelings around that and how do we process that. And we talked with some parent groups that had brought us the signs originally as kind of a nice gesture. We had to run the basis with our administrative team and really regather them and think about, you know, possible outcomes to that. And what we ended up doing, and I talked a little bit about this before, we realized that the signs really were not the issue. What it really was we needed a way to communicate directly with our community about what we valued and an inclusive environment that we wanted to do. So we met over the summer, and one, we did the protocols for responding to hate incidents. But then in addition, we also, as a team, an entire administrative team, did a subcommittee, and I was a part of that. Excuse me. And we developed something we called the Letter of Inclusivity, which we sent out to families at the beginning of the school year, and we actually penned with all 36 or so of our administrators in the district. We all signed that by hand as a commitment to what we wanted for inclusive values in the community. And I think it was a way that we were able to kind of come back together and state what we wanted for our students. I chose the issue, so I guess it's kind of my own fault for choosing that issue, because there's so much emotion latent in that issue within different pockets in our community that I really can't do it service. Talking about it in public forum and also being respectful of all the individuals we work with. But it was certainly an issue that was, you know, not one that we sometimes call technical versus adaptive. It was really strongly on the adaptive side. It was about working around beliefs, it was about working around feelings. And I think we tried to approach it first and foremost as a feeling issue. And I think we ended up having some positive outcomes to that. But it was probably a 3-month problem. Back over, swing back to the left and see if there's any questions. Yes? Sure. So the question was, what do, in my estimation, the greatest challenges as a district? So maybe what I'll do is I'll share what an entry process looks like for a superintendent, because I think in my career, have always been very scared of people that will come in, and having been able to now spend, you know, one day talking with, you know, three people from each stakeholder group of four people, send the district in a new direction. I don't think that's a reasonable or responsible approach for someone coming in. So what I'll do is I'll talk a little bit about some trends that I think I'm hearing over the course of the day today, but with a really strong caveat that I don't think that should be generalized at this point. As part of a transition process in, I would expect that probably between July and January of the school year, I'd be setting up a whole series of stakeholder meetings with students, families, faculty, support staff, administrators, and really doing a lot of listening across the district as well as a lot of data study. And then coming back to those different groups and testing some theories and hypotheses And then about halfway through the first year, then you might come out and say, here are some trends and patterns I think I can now validate through a whole series of data and interviews and discussions like that. So I think that would be more of the approach that I would choose to take coming in the door. But some things that have bubbled up over the course of the day and my first interview, I think special education is an opportunity that I'm hearing. You know, I know you mentioned it earlier, but I also heard that in another group this morning, and I also heard it in my first interview, that, you know, kind of communication around special education, but also programming for students and making sure that there are a variety of programs in place to meet students' curriculum needs is something that I heard. Another comment that I believe I've heard now from a few different groups is that of the growth of the community and trying to, you know, maintain the school culture, and with that growth come a couple of different issues. A financial issue about how do you continue to have a school budget that is always a year behind in terms of funding from the state, or funding, you know, based on the previous year's enrollment when you're experiencing high growth in a year. And what do you plan to do long term about kind of continuing growth? And I forget the exact number, but I think I saw somewhere 900 new housing units or housing starts in the community. It was very, very high. That's an area we do a lot with our local department to make sure we're communicating about, to understand where enrollment trends are going. I also have heard that with this idea of growth comes increased diversity, and that there are times when some people in the school district feel like that's going to be a challenge and an opportunity for the district to really look at that concept of inclusive schools. I think I've looked at that across the day previously. I think there's kind of a technical challenge of opening the school in Arizona, and I was able to tour that today in the sense of closing a central school and opening Arizona. That's a technical challenge. I think there are some other facilities issues I've heard from some of the community members a couple of times today. So again, I really want to put a caution on that's unvalidated data back, but it certainly is data that I've heard from a variety of sources throughout the course of my time in Huntington. So hopefully that kind of targets some of your thoughts as well. Sure. I think some of the innovations that hold the most potential are technology that's able to respond to students' various performance levels and personalize instruction to meet the needs of students at a variety of levels. And I was able to talk with one of the principals today where our school is piloting some software that's able to do that across a couple of classrooms. So you might have students within one classroom working on material that's either at grade level, extended beyond grade level, or approaching grade level. And I think that, to me, may be the most powerful technology that we're on the verge of in education. I think there's really, you know, three broad uses of technology that I always look at. This test board is going to be effective. Can it increase our collaboration? Can it increase communication? And can it increase access to information? The collaboration has been the most powerful element for us in our district as we move to a remote environment where students are now working in teams curricularly at a grassroots level. So we might have a writing assignment that multiple students are working on, and that to me far more approximates what students will have in their careers later in life, because we know that the world does not work in isolation anymore. People are working, you know, across geographic regions, everything else, but it's still on the same projects. And teaching students how to collaborate early is a really critical step in all of that. But I still think leveraging personalization is going to be key in the next 5 years. There's a wonderful organization called MAPLE, which is a Massachusetts Personalized Learning Network, And there are some districts now on cutting edge of joining that. Don't think I saw Huntington in there. And we're not there as well in my community, but it's something we started discussions about, getting involved with that, because it's really focusing on making sure each student gets behaved out of the school system and not just the kids in an aggregate in the world.
Several years. So about my background. I began as a classroom teacher. I still envision myself as an educator. I think what is central that we do as part of education is teach students. The most important role that we have in our district is truly that of a classroom teacher. The experience that students have with their classroom teacher is critical. The connection that teachers make with students really sets the tone for the students as they move through our system. As a classroom teacher, I then had an opportunity to work as an instructional technology specialist. I broadened my vision of what schools are about. I worked with teachers, coaching, modeling, ensuring that technology was used in a way that enhanced what was happening in the classroom. True purpose and why the technology was being used. From there, I had an opportunity to be a technology director, both for the Leicester Public Schools and Hopkinton Public Schools. And again, it was my introduction to central office, leading at a larger level, systems thinking, working very closely with superintendents, central office leaders, and building principals. In helping set and bring a vision to fruition. From there, I had an opportunity to be a principal both at the Leicester Public Schools and Hopkinton Public Schools. And again, for me, it broadened my experience, my understanding, my perspective of the work that building principals do, the work that teachers do, and how building leaders support day-to-day operations. It also helped set the vision for the school. It also gave me an opportunity to work very closely with parents and help parents navigate parenting, but also educating their children. And it also gave me a great experience working very closely with students and connecting with students as a principal. For the past 4 years, I've been assistant superintendent for public schools of Northborough and Southborough. Northborough and Southborough School District has a very unique setup and makeup. Southborough has a pre-K to 8 school system that has its own school committee, its own governance, town manager, and selection. Northborough parallels that structure. They have their own school committee, town manager, town structure. Students regionalize at the high school. So Northborough and Southborough students attend Algonquin Regional High School, who again has its own school committee who leads and governs the high school. So one of the challenges is that we have three budgets. We have the Northborough budget, we have the Southborough budget, and we have the regional budget. And a lot of the work that the superintendent and I do, ensuring that priorities are aligned, that we're working collaboratively across the towns, and that there's parity of experiences at the elementary level in terms of access to resources and professional learning, and that when students arrive at Algonquin, they're all prepared to succeed and there's parity of knowledge. With three different systems, there are a total of 20 school committee seats, which has been a great experience because there's no shortage of school committee meetings that we need to go to experience. The Northborough School Committee has a committee of 5, along with the Southborough School Committee has a committee of 5, and the region has a committee of 10. They meet every Wednesday, so if you never want to know where I am on Wednesdays, that's cool. And then once a month, they meet as a combined across all divisions. But in all intents and purposes, the district operates as one. The central office focuses on supporting Northborough, Southborough region. And we have a saying, 10 schools, 3 districts, 1 community of partners. And we really focus on providing support for our building administrators and our building leaders. strategic plan, what are the strategic goals we're focusing on, and making sure that there's alignment with those goals across the systems. I'm very proud of the work that I've been part of in Northboro, South Carolina. It's a great school system. And my intention was to remain there and be in a position to compete for the superintendency when that position may come out. When I heard that Dr. McLeod was retiring, knowing my experience in Hopkinton, the commitment to education, the high quality of the leadership team, the educators, the talented students, I made a decision that this is a place I'd love to compete for in terms of being Hopkinton's next semester. So that's a little bit about me and where I've been very quickly. I'd be happy to answer some questions. actually is going to help that student grow and gain the skills he or she needs to close that gap. Too often we look at special ed students and think that just doing more of the same is going to have the same outcomes. So we need to be strategic, we need to be thoughtful, we need to implement research-based specialized instruction that's going to meet the students' needs. And if we repeat that, because it truly is an individualized education plan, that over and over again, targeted and specific with each IEP, I think we'll see actually making things begin to close down.
Greg, you mentioned about the
rapid
pacing change in the world. Form relationships across lines of difference. Tony Wagner talks about how you really have to onboard all of the community in terms of the why of changing schools. How does that maybe inform the point of existence?
So I think that one of the challenges that we face in the education system is people bring their own experiences to the table. So, school looks very different than it does 10, 15, 20 years ago. And oftentimes, parents relate to their child's experience through their own experience and what they experience as a student. Being a parent in today's age is very different than being a parent 15, 20 years ago. Being a student, being a child growing up today is very different than a child growing up 15 to 20 years ago. And I think the why is very important. Providing opportunities for the community to engage in conversations around what does education look like? What skills and knowledge do students need as they lead our educational system to be successful in college and career? In Northboro, South Road, we have a speaker series. Variety of topics around from anxiety, raising well-packed students to technology and education. We try to engage parents in conversations around what the world requires in terms of knowledge and skills, and what this school environment looks like, and how it needs to align to parents' students in the future. I think engaging parents in conversations. Having focus groups, any chance of speaker series, having opportunities to engage in dialogue is essential to the classroom.
Okay, what have you done, or what would you do to help students really celebrate the joy of learning, and teachers to celebrate the joy of teaching? How do we bring it back?
So I think that. Communities where there are very high expectations, high expectations from the community, and high expectations from families, and where students place high expectations on themselves, it's very challenging. I think really having conversations around quality of life and balance. Our students, South Park, high school level. We talk about some stressors. We talk about the level of work and amount of homework. We talk about the technology, the stress technology brings. And we talk about sleep and lack of sleep. I think we need to really, as a community, engage in those conversations around helping students find balance in learning, finding balance in life. Students need to well-rounded, they need to follow their passions, they need time to reflect and think, they need time to rest. And I think we can do all this without compromising student achievement. But it is a hard message to get across, because I think communities are fearful that if they stop doing this at this level, that the result is going to be lack of success in college entrances. And I think it's a continued dialogue. What's the purpose, what's the goal, and how can we create environments for students where they find balance and still have high levels of achievement?
have that kind of ongoing. We have an incredibly caring community of staff and students, and this is like what they're for over here. We all care very much about this decision, but it's hard. There's a lot going on in the world. How do you create space to have meaningful conversations when you can't get it together?
I think it's not an easy task to do. I think you have to continue to have forums, although this might be a small number of folks. People came out to listen, ask questions, to be engaged. Even if there are only X number of parents in town to take the forum, I think it's important to have the conversation, because it doesn't need to be, you just need to start large and start small. You can have the conversation in small pockets, and it's essential. I think having a conversation with our teachers, our educators, having a conversation with our, with the leadership team, having opportunities to engage in conversation with parents, families, and students. We also have data to support that our students are feeling stressed. They are feeling at capacity. And I think we need to share the data, have conversations, and then think about what we can do as an educational community to help students find the joy, find the passion, find the balance that I think is important to find.
If you were a parent for that discussion, what would you suggest?
Well, in terms of parenting, I will talk about the impact that anxiety has on a student. That if a student is feeling anxious, if a student is feeling stressed, there is research that shows that a student's IQ actually dips and drops. So if our students are constantly coming to school feeling anxious and stressed about the work, we're not getting the best out of our students. So one of the things I talk about and educate is what impact does stress and anxiety have on the learning environment, and how does it impact the student's ability to learn, and how does it impact the student's IQ? You all experienced it where we've been in stressful situations such as interview, and you can't remember something that you know you should remember because you're anxious. Your working memory decreases, your recall decreases. And it's not that you can't recall that information, it's just that you're in a stressed environment, you're feeling anxious. If you step outside of that environment and you're more relaxed, not anxious, not stressed, you're able to take information in more and react to it in a different way. So that's one of the things that I love that conversation, to provide educational opportunities to have the experts come in and talk about the impact of stress. Did I answer your question? I'm a parent. I have a 16-year-old daughter. I think I'm part of the problem. To be honest, she's scheduled. She has a busy schedule. There are pressures that my wife and I have placed on her that are not intentional, but are there in our household to perform well. There are pressures that the community places on her. So it's a lot, and I don't have an easy answer. But my wife and I try to be mindful of giving my daughter space, giving her time to breathe, time to reflect, try to as much as we can minimize overstanding.
I have a question related to the role of leadership in creating culture, and I wondered if you could reflect on your role in your Principal Hopkins or your current position, some of the routines or methods or behaviors you model to help create culture in your institution.
It's So I think that I think one of the most important aspects of a leader's job is to hire the right people. I had the fortunate pleasure of hiring a number of very talented educators throughout my career. Most recently, in Northborough, Southborough, we've had a lot of attrition. We've had a high school principal retire. We've had a student support director of student support. Our director of finance and operations retired. So whenever you have someone leave an organization, there's a risk because they leave with knowledge and experience. It's also an opportunity to bring in a person who can add to and bring the level of expertise that might not have been. So I'm very proud of hiring at the Northborough, Southborough School District has done over the past couple of years. Some of the leadership positions. And then in terms of working and collaborating with the leadership team, very collaborative in nature. Make sure my expectations are clear. I believe in a distributed leadership model, a model where I'm not the only person in the room to lead. I don't need to be the smartest person in the room. And it's essential to rely on that expertise those around you to make informed decisions in the best interests of kids. So at this end, purposeful meetings that focus on the work that needs to be done. I model respect. I always talk about hard on ideas, easy on people. It's okay to be a hard on an idea with the understanding that we always need to be respectful of the people behind those ideas. I always look for the right attitude and train for skill. If someone has the right attitude, you can always teach them the skills of knowledge. Provide them with professional opportunities to develop those skills of knowledge. And then attitude will help them foster and develop the knowledge. I've been very fortunate to work with people who've only needed my support and guidance and positive reinforcement that they're doing the right things. If you try to listen and tell me they need something, I try to make sure that that happens for them. But I've been very fortunate to work with a lot of the educators. I haven't needed much to grow and develop, just in here. One question.
Sorry, it's not possible. So what experience have you had with budgets? I mean, we've had a discussion about working with budgets, dealing with school committee, dealing with town manager, dealing with town meeting.
So since I've been technology director or building principal, bring that lens in terms of building technology budget, building-based budget, and collaborating with educators and district folks to develop those budgets. But in the last 4 years, I've been involved in developing district-wide budgets, and it is a collaborative process. And we work very closely with town leaders in both North Hills and Southborough to understand the town context. We work to understand what the priorities of the town are and understand what the guidelines and parameters they set for us as we move forward into the fiscal year. It's always a changing landscape, starting with the state level, trying to predict and project as much as you can what the economic climate is going to look like. But then in terms of the budgeting process, we really start with outcomes. What are we trying to accomplish? What are we trying to achieve? And our conversation centered around what are we trying to achieve and what resources do we need to make that happen. Sometimes we can accomplish those goals without a financial impact. Other times we do need to request additional funding or funding of certain items. Those are conversations that we have. We work very closely with the school committees to have strategic budget priorities as we enter the budget season. And we engage with the school committee, budget subcommittees often around where we head, what goals we're trying to accomplish, what does the financial landscape look like, and ultimately present a budget that is educationally sound and fiscally responsible. It takes a collaborative process. Context is important in terms of town. You can get a budget through and lose the battle. You can push a budget through that maybe was outside the parameters of a recommendation from the town manager or selectman and finance committee. But in the spirit of collaboration, I don't think that's the best process possible. I think you expand short-term capital for maybe a longer-term gain in terms of collaboration. The school committee is one department, the school department is one department depending on the town, and there are many competing priorities. And we always try to put ourselves in the context of the priorities of the town.
So I want to go back to the first question you asked, right, the role of technology in creating an sort of individual policy. But on the topic of creating a more personalized education using technology. So do you have any experience in that area? Is that something that you find having in your experience?
Yeah, so that's exactly what I think the future of technology will allow us to do is have personalized learning environments for students that are adaptive as students progress through learning. At Algonquin Regional High School, we've implemented a learning management system called Canvas. I know Hopkinton High School uses the same platform. And one of the things we're talking about is looking at that learning management system and how can we build those personalized learning experiences? How can we build those pathways for kids so that they can navigate, and a student can navigate his or her own level? How we can look at mastery learning. If a student enters a course and already knows two-thirds of the content, how can we create pathways for that student to move beyond what would be offered in a traditional course? Canvas has a lot of potential in that area in terms of building learning pathways for students, aligning content, having that assessment system built in so students are constantly learning and assessing, and based on the assessment data, environments being adapted for the student. I think that's the trend that we'll see in the future in terms of these tools. Canvas is a great product. They have are a market player in a lot of colleges and universities, and I only see the technology expanding and increasing in terms of personalized.
Can you provide a specific example of a problem or a challenge that you face
that. Share an example that hasn't come to a resolution, but it's like, so school start time is something that we've been engaged in talking about, having the high schools start later for a number of scientific reasons. It makes a lot of sense. We've been engaged in a lot of conversations with the community around how can we shift the high school start time later. The students can actually sleep. Scientific research is going to help. We had Dr. Owens, who is a sleep study expert, kind of present to the community around the science behind sleep and why it's essential for adolescents to get sleep, what the impacts are, if they do not. The challenges that we're facing right now, that because we are a regional school system, we get regional reimbursement for transportation, and we tear off from our bus routes from the high school to the towns of Northbrook, Southbrook. So one of the challenges is just a fiscal challenge in terms of we don't have enough buses to tear off and start there without significantly impacting the towns of Northbrook, Southbrook. So we're engaged in those conversations. We have a study group looking at potential solutions. Engaging the bus company. We haven't solved the problem yet, but we're committed to finding a solution. It's going to take some time, and it might take some financial resources, and we're hopefully coming up with a solution in the next year or two, because the research has been done. But our process is to have conversations, to have dialogue.
Being the best soccer player.
school was a good experience. It was a great experience. But the coaches that I had, the relationships I built on the soccer field, the lessons I learned through playing soccer at high school, live with me today, I think contribute to who I am in terms of my core values and my work ethic, and also who I am. That's how you
would
like to
do it.
So.
I hope you were good.
I was. I'm proud. We won the state championship, so I was very proud of that. I was an All-American. I was a high school All-American. So I'm proud of that. So I might not have been the top of the class. I had a lot of college offers.
So I think what I'm hearing is you're taking that experience to inform how you view a student in high school today, and talking about balance, you know, so that you want them to come out with world skills, life skills, as well as the grades and the.
So I think for me it's about helping students make meaningful connections. So I think when students are at our high school, I think what can make a world of difference between a good experience and a great experience is having a great connection with an adult at the high school level, whether it's an educator, whether it's a coach, whether it's a music teacher. It doesn't really matter who, and it doesn't really matter what the passion is, but I think it's important that students leave our high school having a passion, having a dedication to having a passion, having people who are connected to their success, and having students understand that there are adults in this world that care about them and want them to see them succeed. I think for me that's an important piece of my lessons learned in high also very appreciative of each of you for taking the time to come and ask questions and to get to know me. And honestly, all I would like is that Hockington find the best superintendent for the town. And if that's me, it would be a great honor. And I would work hard to earn people's respect over time. And I would do my best to be the best leader possible for the community. So I wish the town nothing but the best. I know it can be, succession is a critical point in communities. And you're at that point, I hope you find the best leader. So thank you.
Instructed to use the microphone tonight because this is being viewed on cable for those who can't make it. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming out tonight. I know it's a very busy time of year, so there's a number of conflicts throughout the community for you to be here to learn about me and the future of your district. It is very much appreciated. I spent all day in the community talking to parents, talking to teachers and students and administrators. We have a wonderful school system. So here tonight is an opportunity for you to learn a little bit about me, my background, and what I could possibly bring to the Uxbridge Public Schools. Currently, I am the superintendent of schools in Uxbridge. This is my sixth year there. Prior to that, I was a director of education at a special education school, a principal at a middle school, an assistant principal at a middle school and high school, an assistant principal at an elementary school, and I started my career as a guidance counselor. Over the course of the past 17 years, or nearly 20 years, my guidance background, my personal mission has been to work with educators, work with families, work with communities to develop young children into independent, successful citizens. That's the big picture. And I've been fortunate to work in communities and in schools where that's been a shared mission. So I bring that to you today with that thought in mind. What are we doing together to develop young people into contributing, successful, independent citizens? As we look at what our requirements are in education, in a community like Hockington, and why people like me want to be a part of it, it's a destination district. It really is. People are wanting to move here. As you know, Hockington is the fastest growing community in the Metro West. At a time when most districts throughout the Commonwealth of Massachusetts have declining enrollment. So that goes to show that many families are moving to Uxbridge with children to have their kids educated here. And that's a terrific sign. But it also brings challenges as well, correct? And what are those challenges that we should welcome? Because it's an attractive place to be. Like I'm telling you that it's a destination spot. People are telling you that it's a destination place for them. And people are coming into this community that haven't been here, that haven't been a part of generational cultures. So I look forward to having a conversation with you about some of those challenges tonight and really turning it over to you to ask questions about me and my background. With you in this community. So I think there's only one mic here, so that to ensure that it goes home to televisions, we'll share it. Okay. Anyone have any questions? There's a good handful of people in this room that have heard my spiel already today, so I don't expect to be that.
I'm glad to hear you have a guidance background. I'm the director of guidance at Hockington High School, Lee Greco. And what you say about this being a destination spot, I think we're getting a lot of statewide and national recognition. And you know, the rankings, which are taking the lead on, but it's definitely bringing a claim to us, and a lot of it has to do with the number of AP exams that we give. With that, all of those AP exams comes an awful lot of pressure on our students. And I can understand parents being kind of stuck in this quandary between wanting the best for their kids, wanting their kids to get a college degree. Now it has to be a college degree from a selective institution because they're anxious about their child's chances of having a fruitful future. So we're kind of stuck between that, and then at the same time, we have really solid, wonderful families here that also want to see their kids happy and healthy and, you know, having a level of a balanced life. So, I don't have any answers. I don't expect you to, but I'd just love to hear what your thoughts are about this quandary that people face now.
Thank you. That was a terrific question. I have a lot to say about this. I hope nobody has any place to go for the next couple of hours. It's a real issue, not just in Hopkinton and in places. And we've had many conversations today about this very challenge. Sometimes, particularly adolescents, their schedules are more taxing than the schedules that we have as adults. They're getting on the buses at 6:15, 6:20 in the morning. We want them to have a well-rounded background as they're considering what they're going to do post high school. Making them more, not just because we want them to make them more attractive for colleges or the workforce. We believe that's an important fabric of being a strong American, being a strong student. If you compare our nation to other nations in terms of what the academic and school structure is like, it's rounded with music instruction and performing arts and athletics. It becomes an identity of who we are or once were. Who I was as a student athlete is still very much a part of me today as it was 30 years ago. It was part of my schooling that I valued. So how do you keep that in place while dealing with the pressures of, say, a high-performing community and district like this, when yes, the pressure is to see how many advanced placement courses that you can put on that transcript so that you're marketing yourself for the most challenging and competitive colleges? Is that the end goal is the question that we have to start having and having conversations with each other about, because it will add pressures to students to chase grades, to chase transcripts, to lose sight of, I'm building an academic program and I'm studying and building skills for something that I want to pursue as a career. I think if we flip our thinking a little bit, because right now the thought process is on, as the pressures of keep maintaining a high-performing school district is making sure that that graduation rate is in the high 90s, if not 100%. Making sure that the majority of our students take AP courses. First of all, let's make sure that we're taking more AP courses than anyone else. And then let's make sure that our kids are passing AP courses more than anyone else. And let's make sure that we're above average in SATs. Let's make sure that we're 20 to 30 points higher than the state average on MCAS tests. That pressure starts to build up at a very young age. So how to change that? It takes a long time, but what you do is you start dreaming with kids. What do you want to be when you grow up in preschool and kindergarten? And how do we take those dreams, inform them, and guide the students into establishing, say, two goals a year, with something that you're very strong in, and something that you may believe may lead to something that you're going to do in life. It can start as early as elementary school, doing that now in many places. And what are other areas, what's another area that you're not so strong as a student that you think that you could be better, that you could grow? When we look at that second goal of where can we achieve better, and students start to own that as a young person, they start to see with their teachers that with effort, with measuring, you do grow over the course of the year, even in what you perceive you're weak. So as these goals transition from one year to the next, it starts to lead to an academic plan. It starts to lead towards a pursuit of further studies, both in secondary schools and in higher education. So what's happening is the student is starting to identify with himself, his or her strengths and weaknesses, and what that career path may be. So it's a shift in mindset. It's not I'm just chasing the grade to get on the, you know, to get on the honor roll and to maintain an honor roll, to make myself eligible for honors classes, to make myself eligible for AP, to make myself marketable for higher education. You can easily fall into the trap of putting those blinders on rather than who am I as an individual, as a student? Who am I as a person? How are my skills and my interests, how are they matching? Where are they leading? What are they leading to? I think if you look at some school districts who take this approach, have students who have less anxiety, those things still fall into place in terms of high AP scores, high graduation rates. But what those schools start to do is they start to build pathways for their school. They take a look at the workforce around them. What are the needs of society in and around where you're living or through the state? And if we're polling our students and there's a commonality of what kids want to pursue based on their strengths, based on what we're able to offer as a school system, they start to chase the skills that they need to be successful in. And some of those other things take care of themselves. So if we start building goals early for the intent, and let's start talking about what does the profile of a Hopkinton High School graduate look like, and let them know and communicate that early, I think students start to plan better, they start to organize better, they start to manage their time better. Every college-bound student, I think, in Hopkinton should take an AP course or a college-level course. I think every high school student should take at least one online course. And I think if we start to plan and develop something, every senior, by the time they're a senior year, are enrolled in a job internship or participating in a capstone project, that's doable. So we start chunking the responsibilities from the early age and starting to share that ownership with kids. We can do it through open circle. We can do it through responsive classrooms at the elementary level. We can do it through advisory as it gets into middle and high school level. We can break down and stop the music so that these kids have a chance to learn the process of who they're going to become. And you focus on the skills. You're not transfer chasing. And that doesn't mean that that transcript doesn't look like what you want it to. It's just you have a clearly defined path in what you're trying to build. And what you're trying to build is skills that's going to lead into, and hopefully, a vocation for me. That's really an avocation. And getting up because I love doing what I love to do, and it's built around my skills. And I think there are many school districts that are now shifting in that direction. It's alleviating stress. So, plan well, start setting goals from each grade level, and even at the primary levels, with a plan. I talked to the administration team today. By September, I would love to see every senior have an articulated plan of what they're doing after they leave out here. Saying, you're just going to college is not enough, or you're going to work is not enough. We want to see FAFSA complete. We want to see college recommendations. We want to see applications ready to go out in the first term, you know? And so when you talk, listen, this, I think everyone in this room at one point or another, even in your adult lives, and I know you too, procrastinate a little bit at home. Think about that 16 and 17 year old that a lot is building up all at once. You're upperclassmen, you're involved in many clubs and activities. Now you're thinking about leaving your community where you most likely grew up for most of your life. You're going on to college, or you're going off to the military. And things that you are supposed to take care of, you love to last minute. We can knit that in the bud and just start smart from the primary levels up to the middle schools and high schools. So everybody has a plan. If it's not September 1, by December break, all articulated plans are complete. So you can certainly a stress reducer. We could talk for months and months about this, but I think that's one way to go about it.
It happens to be.
You have a candidate.
Can you just tell me what your
community involvement has been in Uxbridge and the type of things that you've attended?
Well, as a superintendent, you try to attend as many events as possible. For me, one of the strategies I use, if you're inviting me to it, I'm gone. I've got to be there. There is those things that, though, you can't be in two or three places at once. Our schedules are often heavy with even meetings because volunteers and, say, school committees or boards of selectmen, finance committee, they all happen in evening. So around this stretch of time between late November and March, we're at three meetings a night during the week while student events are going on. I think most people in these positions will tell you they'd rather be, and I probably will go to the band concert after this because my injury got bumped to tomorrow, but there's usually a conflict of things. Another way to stay connected when I first came to Uxbridge is I did listening tours. So I would seek out parents who wanted to host a neighborhood, you know, in the spring and the summer. If you're having a barbecue and you just want to talk shop, no agenda, I will attend the event. I may even bring an administrator with me. And the agenda is yours. Talk about anything you want to. Again, just to stay connected, in the trenches of the community. That evolved into going to, say, a Dunkin' Donuts and hosting where the school committee chair and I would be for them to swing by and talk about anything that they want to. But the traditional things are, certainly the athletic and the music events are things that you go to. Seniors at the center events, I don't know if Hopkinton has a senior center where they deliver turkeys like around Thanksgiving, but those are things that I've participated in, working with other town leaders and delivering turkeys to new families or to senior citizens who really can't get out and go shopping. Anything to be part of the community, I want to do, but I need the help of all of the different things that are going on or from representatives from all the different groups to get me in that room and so that I can be a part of it. Because there's so many things going on each and every day. Look at the conflicts tonight. We've got a school committee interview happening right now. A superintendent forum for a finalist, a band concert. I think there's youth basketball going on right now. It's not that Hopkinton people don't care about this stuff. They do. You can see it in the thorough process that they're doing to replace Dr. Cloud when she retires. People have lives too. And life sometimes get in the way of being a guru and teaching. So my approach is if you invite me, I'm doing everything that I can do, no matter what it is. But those neighborhood visits, I think are very helpful when you're trying to increase engagement, conversation. Otherwise, if you're seeing the superintendent at a school meeting, providing presentations, or you're just seeing him or her in the stands at a football game or a basketball game, these are the things that you want to talk about. Those are things that we can tap into. If there's interest in it. So there was interest early on, but then that kind of faded away. If I was in Hopkinton, people wanted to get 15 people in the back deck, I'm all about that. I can talk dogs all about it, but anyway.
Based on what you've seen so far and heard through your interviews, what are two things that really impress you about Hopkinton, and what are two things that you either change or bring in yourself that you would personally offer?
Okay, let me try to answer this. I'm always reluctant to flip the switch too fast. I don't think I've been in the district long enough to say that's a problem, that needs to change. There are three types of districts. There are districts where you need transformative change. There are districts that are on the cusp of being good school systems or great school systems. And then there are systems like Hopkinton. If you're just looking purely at the numbers, it's a great system, okay? That will continue to evolve. So when a superintendent, and there's challenging work in each of those types of districts, and I've been in two of them. And this is the third one, is the third that I just described for Hopkinton as being an outstanding school system that has the opportunity to evolve or take off, as I've heard some superintendents in my circles said. So the good thing about being a school administrator in both the Metro West, Northern Worcester County, Southern Worcester County, over the last 17 years as an administrator, I've been able to develop relationships that go as far east as Wellesley and as far west as Dudley Charlton. So the word about you and what you're doing is off the charts right now. Everyone who's ever been in a leadership position understands that leadership is situational. How your role, your approach can change from one day to the next, or from one conversation to the next, depending upon the circumstances. But every leader wants to lean back on what he or she feels most comfortable in, and where he or she's found greatest success. So I think at the core of my leadership approach is a collaborative leadership style. Who works hard at distributive leadership, to share the roles of leadership and sharing the steering wheel, so to speak, on where a school system can go. When I can lean back on that style more often than not, I feel satisfied in what I'm doing. And that's what's attractive for Hopkinton for me. So I can't quite answer what would I come in and flip right away. I don't think that's the concern. I think I've alluded to some of those. If I was here, I'd be working with the administration team to start working on goal development for really good kids. Okay. Finding flexible time in each of the schedules so that you're allowing, you're providing the opportunity to build soft skills. There's going to be a time and place. We just mentioned about the transcripts. That employers do not care about transcripts or where you went to high school or college. What they care about is, are you able to function in a team? Can you problem solve? Can you fail and recover from failure? Are you resilient? Are you a self-motivated person who can self-learn? Meaning, you haven't been exposed to this before, but I'm gonna, tinker with it and figure it out on my own. And then share that knowledge with other people. Those are what we call soft skills that matter most for the sustainability of a successful employment. We start building that at a young age for kids. Again, you can do it in many different formats: responsive classrooms, open circles, advisory, or in a physics class. It doesn't have to be just the guidance office where you talk about those things. It's all in, all of us, being aware of the skill package that kids need to be successful once they grow up. And over time, knowing what our strengths are as a school system, and knowing what the employment force around, the workforce around us needs, and we'll develop those high-skilled, high-wage. We're not producing the jobs, we're providing the talent and making sure those kids are entering high-skilled, high-wage jobs. We will have a strong partnership with the business community in Hopkinton. We will have a strong partnership with higher education. It will be a trifold effort, moving forward. That's how school systems are evolving. And I'm not talking about tipping the apple cart with our administration team or our teachers, changing everything way we're doing things. You have a foundation here that's very, very strong. Your strategic plan is very well done. It's broken down into silos, those most important areas of effective leadership through effective instruction to assessment, all the way down to obviously governance. So in Department of Education, Elementary and Secondary Education comes into Hopkinton, you've already broken it down in the columns that they're looking to analyze. And you have theories of action for each of those. Okay. That doesn't need to be torn up or done. You can continue to build off that for many, many years. Did I answer your question? You sure?
I moved to Hopkinton about 4.5 years ago and have three children, two in the schools now, and currently going to be starting in about a year, so I have a huge vested interest in where the future of this town is going, especially the schools. And when my wife and I moved here, one of our big decisions was for the schools. And I've had the pleasure of knowing Kevin for about 32 years and we grew up together. And I can tell all the people here that haven't had the opportunity to know him and walk by his side for the last 32 plus years. He's as good as a man as he has been an educator. And one thing I've always noticed is that his moral compass always goes in the right direction. He is the type of person that I would be honored to stand before you and tell you he'd be a great person for this job. Not just because of his background, but because who he is as a person. And my question on top of that is, knowing your background, knowing you've been a superintendent for the last 6 plus years, and the last 20 years of being involved in education, what has been, you think, the major success in Hillsborough? And how would you bring those visions and goals to Hockington to keep us on this path?
Thanks, John. I think sometimes your greatest successes aren't the ones that are always celebrated or out in front for the world to see. It's what happens behind the scenes. So one of the challenges, and one of the administrators in the room was also working in that district. So one of the challenges that Uxbridge had, they went through a civil war to get their high school built. When I was in Ashland, we opened up a school. We went for a new school through the MSBA. The same year, our high school opened up in 2006, Uxbridge opened up in 2012. So it took them twice as long, and after many failed votes at town meeting. One of the things, when you look at the design of the school, it's a beautiful school, but programmatically, it was built in reaction to something that was happening. We have a wonderful, very successful regional technical high school in the region, Roxton Valley Tech. It has a waiting list of something like 900 kids every year. And many, it's the premier college prep school as a technical school in the Blackstone Valley. Not many deny that. So what happens when that happens, there's a perception, sometimes a reality, that the students who should be accepted into that school are not being admitted. And that leads the local school to adapt its programming to best meet those needs. That was discovered in my first year there. And you see, the best way to describe it in a tangible way is, you've been to Cheesecake Factory. I think most of the people in this region have been to Cheesecake Factory at least once. They've got a menu that goes on forever. So that's what we had at Uxbridge High School. We had many, many electives. But what we had was, we didn't have an elective base that supported the core. We had vocational courses that didn't lead to anything. We had some students that were on an Ivy League track and then needed to take an engineering degree term to take landscaping design. Nothing wrong with landscaping design. If it fits in a program, you know, as part of agricultural studies, great. But you need multiple courses for that. Landscape design could do anything for you, furthering education or employment. So what happened was, they were building programs and course offerings for those kids who were denied acceptance into the regional vocational school. We've got to do something for these kids. But what they built was something they could not afford. And why we went to regional vocational schools in the first place, having vocational programming on top of college prep, comprehensive high school model, it's very difficult to run full programs and make it both work. So what did communities do? They took money off the top of their budgets and they created a regional system, a different program for kids to go that needed that type of education. We're changing our thinking about vocational education again, though, folks, and I think you will start to see more of an overlap. But it will be funded appropriately so that full program works. So in terms of my successes, and I was only spoken wheel of this transition, that's what started making my life sink into developing goals early, establishing pathways, building up elective courses off the course so it leads to something. And hopefully work experiences before they leave high school. Thus making the marketability for those high level colleges even more attractive. So if we give kids work experience by their senior year or a capstone, that's more valuable. That's going to be more valuable than what colleges see advanced placement for. That's been a success. On top of it, we're educating people to understand that advanced placement in our day may have been once you get that 3, you get college credits. That may not be the case, you know, to the level that it once was. We're finding that advanced placement is used for placement purposes more at the higher ed level. So let's offer both. Let's provide kids, families, the opportunity to take advanced placement, but let's also allow families and kids to choose college-level courses, meaning our high school teachers, through the partnership with the college, and becoming part of the faculty pool under our roof, but with the nearby community college, are teaching the college-level course and giving credits. That's a success. So we are in line, and we applied for distinction to the Department of Education in Uxbridge to earn that early college pathway distinction and innovation pathway distinction. We are specializing now in manufacturing and engineering at Uxbridge, and I think it's going to be a regional draw. There could be, before my tenure ends in Uxbridge, we're closing a building this year, and I'm hoping that it turns into an early college center, not just for Uxbridge, but for the region. Targeting programming that's there's a critical mass for, but it's just been underdeveloped in the region. And that's with what agricultural studies, that's with biotech. It's going to lead to a merger of higher education and K-12 education. And that's the future. So I can't call that a success yet. I'll be back to let you know if it works. But transforming a high school and being part of a team that say, we've got too many things going in different directions. We've got to narrow our focus. We've got to have a laser focus on what kids need to make them competitive, to build skills, to build a transfer that makes sense and that they're remarkable. So it wasn't there at the beginning, and now it is. Another one was that we didn't have a mathematics program. We didn't have a literacy action plan. Those things are now in place. We didn't have an articulated curriculum from one content to the next. Now it's fully articulated throughout the system. So I leave Uxbridge at a time where I feel like there's a number of things that we were able to accomplish that we set out to accomplish over 5 years ago. And you know, now is that. That was a place that needed transformative change. This is a place where, as my fellow superintendent said, Hopkinson's ready to take off. Something I want to be part of.
So, I mean, I had a chance today to spend a lot of time with, or some time with, our administrators, and hopefully you saw that we have really thoughtful, hardworking administrators in town. But sincerely, they work really hard, as does our staff at all the schools. It's a really passionate group. We don't have a lot of time in this district. People stay, and they care, and they work really hard. So I'd love to hear your thoughts on how you have or would support teachers, administrators, support staff. I think burnout's a real thing. It's hard. It's a hard job. When we're talking about the pressures on our kids, there's a lot of pressure on our staff too. So I'm curious about your thoughts on how do you do that.
Great question. 13 of us superintendents met over the summer with our principals for the purpose of re-examining educator evaluation. We found that our most skilled teachers and our most skilled administrators are the ones who are stressed out the most through this process. My wife's known too, and I can't tell you how frustrated, and it's good for me to see. The laptop never leaves the lap. T-Point is always in my face, whether it's at work or it's at home. It's not me doing it. is I'm very aware of the reporting that administrators need to do. And I'm very aware of producing, you know, evidence and artifacts that teachers need to do. It wasn't supposed to be this way, especially for our most skilled. So what we're trying to do to be supportive, this is just one example of coming together and how we work to simplify it. Because it doesn't need to be as robust, isn't the right word that I'm looking for, but time consuming, and you have many different things that you're doing with the kids and your parents and with each other every day. We have to bring back the power of the conversation about how we're performing, because it's really about the work that we're doing, it's not about the people who are doing the work. And this tool, this system, has made it more about the people doing the work. And it needs to be adjusted. We need to change our thinking about that and our approach. So that visibility, that constant dialogue about how you're doing in your offices, in your classrooms, what can we do in the obstacles for you? Because when we're successful in removing obstacles for teachers, because that's where the magic happens, between the teachers, the support staff, and the kids, everybody is more successful. Everyone's more satisfied with the job. It's when those obstacles pile up and there's not solutions to the problems, that it gets a little messy. So, I hope I'm answering your question the way you were hoping that I would. But just repeat it with the second, I think it was the second part to it.
It was
actually
just about multiple classroom
lessons. I
just
kind of just how you see it. I had Dr. McLeod and I followed a similar path. We both went through what's called the new superintendent induction program, and it's like a major thing that goes on for 3 years. I mean, it's time consuming, it's intense, but you come out, with like a completely different brain and for the better. So a lot of the things that I don't know if you've done consultancies or always practice here in your district, but it's, I can certainly see through your strategic plan, it's the same way I was trained. I know I can just see it by the conversations that I've had with them. They've got to take me together. Direction that they've set for the district, and that's something that if I was here, I'd want to keep moving forward. I knew your former superintendent, that he was probably 3 times removed, but the superintendent was here for 6 years, who I'm still in connection with, was very well respected. And I think Dr. McLeod had the best supporters coming in to understand that. Practices going on and everything on the buildings today. They were the loudest group laughing, having a good time, and I was probably 75 yards away walking around the corner into the meeting room. And you could just see the chemistry with the group. So that's something that staying in touch with them, I alluded to consultancies and problems in practice. That's something that I would bring to the table. It's just be spoken the wheel. We all have a leadership role. It all may be different, but we all have a leadership role and an equal role in many ways. What's your problem that you're struggling with that we can put our brains together and help solve it for you? That's a big stress reliever, and my administration team does that for me.
My question is about special education. In your role as a superintendent, could you give some examples of how you've gone about ensuring that the needs of students and IEPs are met appropriately?
There is a process with special education that can work and not work depending upon where you are and what kind of process you choose to establish. I'll start with that. But setting a level of expectation that the needs of the students are identified by your team. And that includes parents, that includes teachers, that includes administration, and students sometimes, when it's age appropriate, in determining what a level of service is required. Because again, one of the goals of special education when you're providing accommodations is not to provide an accommodation for the rest of one's life. Sometimes the goal of special education is to remove those services eventually, or scale it back, leading to more independent learning and ownership. So as a role with superintendent, I'm meeting with my pupil services director, who's in charge of special ed, 504 accommodations, ELL services, briefly, just she and I. We're also meeting as an admin team weekly. Special education is always a topic of what's going well, what's not. Where are the problem-solving issues at that team level that's around one particular child or two? So the critical issues, the critical cases, I need to be kept up to speed on a timely, regular basis. We're dealing with something in special education, not just in Uxbridge or Hopkinton, but everywhere. Number one, one of the issues is, and we're feeling it in our schools, is that, and it's a success, it's partly a success, where we're servicing more kids on IEPs. Why? The medical profession has advanced far beyond its own expectations, so more kids are surviving premature births today than they were 15 years ago. And with that sometimes comes more advanced developmental disabilities. That becomes a responsibility that a school system must take on. And we accept that responsibility. But as it relates specifically to your question, what do I do to make sure that those accommodations and needs are being met? Again, it's
evaluate your program is, operating.
Yeah. We have what's called a special education review. That's a full program review with DESE. I'm trying to think of it's the mid-cycle and it's the special education one that went through just recently. CPR, coordinated program review. So that's every 6 years, and the cycle's every 3 years. So there's constant monitoring over special education and the legal requirements that we're supposed to provide. That program is a legally binding program for individuals. So my level of involvement and ensuring that we're meeting those requirements is really.
Thank you.
So I just wanted to understand, it's 4 years later, right? Technology's come a long way. I just wanted to understand your thoughts, views on, where we are now on the personalization front and anything that you've done in your current school district.
So, what was just mentioned was that I was a keynote speaker in Beijing, I believe it was 2015. I should know my resume better, but I believe that was the year. And the education system in China and the United States are two very different systems. But there's an intense interest for people from other countries to come and become part of that system here. So China and US have been collaborating together significantly over the last decade in education, and really just to build up cultural intelligence and understanding from one another. It starts with, we have over 150 American companies in China. So it was your former superintendent here that actually planted this in my mind a number of years ago, that studying abroad wasn't necessarily a value when we were going to school. It's kind of like a vacation. I don't have time for that. So he didn't think about this as his kids were growing up, but what he soon realized was that 150 companies over in China, I'm already seeing this with my peer group, that you could be working for, say, Fidelity, and the boss says, pack your bags, you're going to Shanghai for 2 weeks, close this deal. That's a reality now in a global society, in a global economy, in a global workforce.
So that, with that acknowledgement, and that understanding that more families were coming here to enroll their kids at the high school level, not just college, and because they plan on staying longer, really got us our interest piqued. And I think we have come a long way. I think we still have a long way to go. But one of the things that I probably didn't mention earlier when we're talking about what are the foundation areas that we need to cover for our kids in education? Obviously literacy, numeracy, technology, the soft skills. Cultural intelligence is that 21st century skill that doesn't get the equal billing that technology skills get, but it's more important than acquiring second language. It's understanding different customs and cultures, what makes people think, what their value system is, appreciating that it's different than yours, because that's important when you're living in a community. That's important when you both have a job to get a deal done. So you better spend the time in getting to understand what's your motivations. What are your intensity? On the academic and the school front, so say in China, the kids are going to school as early as 7:30 in the morning and leaving at 9:30 at night, sometimes later. They go home for a 2-hour lunch, they go home for dinner, but they're coming back to school. There aren't interscholastic athletics there. They don't necessarily compete with other schools in their cities. It's all about the academics. They do have some time for music through private lessons and whatnot, but when you want to talk about stress, there's a test called the Gallup that everyone takes their senior year. The whole senior year, pretty much the curriculum stops after the 11th grade, and then everybody is studying for the test. 1 point can set you aside whether you're going right to work or in college. And there's an attraction now to learn about our system, because our system is very, very different. Athletics after school, band after school, drama after school, that's part of our academic fabric too. We don't consider it separate, it's part of our schooling. So when you look at it to that scope, we have long days too. We have long, rigorous days. Our efforts are to personalize the instruction on that. We're building school models to, let's say, what fits the kid. And part of those extracurricular and co-curricular activities are part of that. So that's the message that I was trying to deliver in Beijing when we went. We were able to, for a period of time, enroll students from other countries. You know, it gave them a sense of our American culture, but it really changed the thinking of our students who are getting authentic exposure. See, one of the challenges we have in this country, in the state, is we have many people who, with different backgrounds, whether you're Hispanic, whether you're Indian, whether you're Chinese, whether you're Japanese, who've been here for multiple generations now, they're American. But I'm telling you that that exposure, that authentic exposure right from those other countries into the schools has really enlightened kids, it's energized our own kids, and they want more of it. And we need to give them the opportunity to see more of it. 2015, 64,000 kids enrolled into Boston area colleges from China and India, right from China and India. So whether or not you see it here in Hopkinton yet, where your kids are going out to school, they're going to be sitting next to you, is the message. Let's try to incorporate more cultural opportunities for these kids and exposures. Right now, white Anglos are the minority majority across the country. By 2042, I believe, the entire population will be the minority majority. So understanding and being excited about the differences in cultures is really something that's going to prepare our kids well for the global future. We may be still on the cutting edge of welcoming those differences and wanting to explore for the kids.
Sheets.
I hope I was able to answer your questions and share with you part of some of my passions that I think that we can tangibly do here in Hamburg and Hopkinton. If my friends who I trust dearly in the profession are true in what they say that Hopkinton's ready to take off, I'd be so happy to be a part of that and share some of those relationships that I have inter-district-wise with K-12 education, my higher ed partnerships, our business partnerships, and learning. We provide a continuous level of new and more exposures for our kids that lead to skills before they leave and graduate from this. So thank you for having me here and having me tonight. I really enjoyed my time.
The assistant superintendent here in Hopkinton, and I apologize to those of you who have heard this twice today, or maybe even three times, depending on how many times we have been in the interview process together. But if you had asked me a year and a half ago when I had first come to the Hopkinton Public Schools if I would be standing here right now as a candidate before you, I would have absolutely said no. That would not have been my situation whatsoever. And I had just begun working with the superintendent who was, you know, continuing out with the contract, and I knew very little about Hopkinton. I do think that over the last year and a half of my tenure here, I have come to really admire the district, the administrative team, the students who inhabit our schools every day. It's a really lovely place to work, and it has become sort of a nirvana. I mean, it's a wonderful place to be every day. I've been in public education for a very long time, greater than 25 years, and I can tell you that every morning when I wake up, I am happy to come to work in the Hopkinton Public Schools. I have spent a very long time, I think, preparing for a position such as this. I started my career as an English teacher at the high school level, and I quickly became a department chair. Somewhere along the line, I spent 7 years as a teachers union president. A fairly thankless job, but it really does give you a sense of the way teachers think and the kinds of interactions that you need to have when you are solving problems with top-level administrators. I moved from the Auburn Public Schools to the Westboro Public Schools, again, as an English teacher, department chair, and I spent 5 years there as an assistant principal. I then moved to the Uxbridge Public Schools as their K-12 curriculum director, and I landed here a year and a half ago as the assistant superintendent. In that time, I have also taught for Lesley University and Worcester State University. I still do that kind of work. I've had for almost 20 years a private educational consulting business. My partner in that is Arthur Brunel. We do a lot of work through Worcester State University. And so I feel like I've done many, many things that prepare me to work with curriculum, with teachers, with administrators. And I think now, having worked with Dr. McLeod for a year and a half, I would very much like to assume the role of superintendent to kind of keep that momentum that we have going forward. I think that we've built, or at least we're in the incipient stages of building some wonderful programs here in Hopkinton, and I would like to keep that going. So that is why, even if a year and a half ago I didn't think I would be here, I am here before you today. I don't know, this is the part where you ask questions of Nick. Yeah? I think part of my struggle will be, and I was having this conversation last night at home, the degree to which I'm sort of able to leave some of my curricular projects behind, because I am very much invested in them now, but if I am a successful candidate, there will be a replacement for me. And I have a tendency to want to see the things that are going really well continue to go really well, but I know that whoever that person is will be a top level professional who also needs to have the latitude to carve out that position and define it for himself or herself. So I think that that will be a huge change. I also think that I will start to be less in the district and need to start to focus on the outside of the district, and by that I mean interacting with some of those other town departments. As an assistant superintendent, you don't really deal with the town manager, the police, the fire. You do to some degree in terms of, you know, if there is a day when there are down power lines or, you know, there are trees blocking roads, we all kind of pitch in and we come up with safety plans for our children and reroute buses and those kinds of things. But I think that in the top position, you do a whole lot more with the selectmen and other town boards. I think the greatest challenge to our school district is our changing demography. In the last 2 years, we have gone from having about 40 students who are English language learners to 140 students who are English language learners. In the last 10 weeks, so from the time that we submit to the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education our school information data, we have had 38 new students join our district, and only 5 of those students have left our district. We had in our district in FY16 about $54 million of residential new growth value. In FY17, it went up to $101 million in residential new growth value. So you can see that we have lots more housing, and we also have low-income housing. So I think that we have a changing demographic. I think that we are even seeing kids coming into our school district now with IEPs that I am not sure we are prepared to service in the best way that we can today. So I think that we need to build some additional special education programs. I think we need to look at our English language learner instruction. I think that we need to think about what's going to happen when our school buildings are sort of bursting at the seams. NESDEC will give us projections. They tell us that, you know, we will grow sort of slowly and incrementally. I wonder about that. And I wonder about that because I also think that we have baby boomers who withstood the recession, and now these folks who are 65 years old and live in 3 and 4 bedroom homes will sell their property and, you know, will move in their younger families. So I think that those are things that as a district we are going to need to work on. We also have some smaller things that we're sort of building. We're building really great K-5 literacy programs. I've been working with some of the teachers in the middle school and the high school to think about how to change our math trajectory to get most of our kids to calculus before they graduate from Hopkinton High School. So those are the kinds of programs that I have been working on in the last year and a half, but I think in the next 5 years, we have to think very hard about who we are, you know, culturally, academically, behaviorally, socially as a district. I've been going around the district and I use these statistics everywhere I go. In 2007, if you look on DESE's website, it was reported that we were about 94% white. In 2017, as a whole district, we were about 84% white. If you look at Center School's demography, they are currently in this year at 78% white. So you can see that we are a culturally changing place, and I think that our kids, our teachers, our administrators, we all need to figure out how we're going to navigate the changes. Sure. So I have actually been working with some of our CPAC parents, and one of the things that we have discovered is if we're talking about tier one instruction, and tier one instruction is the instruction that every child gets in every classroom every day, I have always been a believer that if you have very, very good tier one instruction, you will have fewer referrals for special education. And if a student doesn't quite get it at tier one, we move our students to tier two. So there may in fact be a student who needs additional phonics instruction. So if we typically stop that in grade two, in grade three, we would carry some more phonics instruction for a student. Or we would have a student work with our math tutor. and it will do some remedial work, and hopefully those kids will build number sense or whatever it is that they're lacking. But then we get to that tier three instruction, which is far more specialized, and I think that that is a place where we could grow some of our programming. I think that we have students who might need some things that we don't currently have in our district, and I don't think that that's enormously expensive to do. There are lots of different other kinds of programs that we might be able to do to get all of our students reading and reading at higher levels, and I think that just through training and having the team kind of come together and take a look at what those kids need, and maybe we are able to take some of the learning specialists currently employed in our district and ensure that they have the skill set to meet some of those students' needs. I told you I've been working with our CPAC parents, and one of the CPAC parents recommended that I reach out to a person whose name is Dr. Joe Petner. He had been an administrator in the Cambridge Public Schools for a very long time. And Dr. Petner actually now works for DESE, but what he did when he was working at the Cambridge Public Schools was he built many, many special education programs. And so I think, you know, my approach very often to building things is to look at how other people have done that and then decide if it's the right approach for Hopkinton. So that's the first stage. I'm meeting with him on December 14th. There are a few people from special education that I'm currently working with. Hopefully we can start taking a group of people and get a subcommittee together to really look at those curricular approaches. I'm not the special education director, so I don't put personnel in those classrooms, but I am responsible for curriculum, and I do think that that's very important to ensure that our kids are getting the special education, very targeted instruction that they need. Well, I think that varies student to student. So I mean, I guess a very good example right now is in our middle school, we have a group of students who all would be described as having intensive needs. But those students have very different diagnoses and they have very different abilities and disabilities. So as we look at some of them, you know, if we have a student who has intensive special needs but is in the eighth grade, say for example, and reads at a sixth grade level, I would say that that student is a good candidate for being in an inclusion setting in a regular eighth grade classroom. And even though there is that 2-year sort of reading deficit that they're not reading at an eighth grade level, we can do so many things where we can have them accessing the same texts, whether kids are listening to that text or whether they're getting that text at another level. So we don't give it to them quite at the eighth grade level, but we give it to them at the sixth grade level. But there are portions of that text that they can read. We can have them preview it through film, and kids can be very successful in that way. However, if you have an eighth grade student who is reading at a second grade level, maybe that student doesn't belong in that classroom, and you know, we only suggest that because there will be times when kids are spending the eighth grade curriculum does a lot of analysis. I mean, that's one of the demands, and if you can't read the text and even read, you know, a far more modified, simplified version of it, then maybe some other kind of reading instruction would be better than sitting for 50 minutes in a classroom where you're not quite getting everything that we would want you to get. So I think it's really about time, where kids can best spend their time and get the most gains in terms of their own personal growth and academic growth.
All about what the school, and it's
it is how we get measured. And frequently, I will say, and this may sound facetious, but it really isn't, even the realtors in Hopkinton are waiting to see those MCAS scores, right? Because honestly, the property values are very much dictated by the success of our public schools. And they are in fact measured by what kinds of SAT scores we have, what kinds of AP courses we're offering, and where our MCAS scores are. And happily, we are doing exceedingly well. If we look at the Ellenwood School in ELA and math last year with the entire new test and all of the promise that next-gen MCAS was going to be wildly challenging, they were fourth in the state. The high schools ranked third. But I will not disagree with you, and I'm not exactly sure that I know how to combat it, but I do think that colleges put all kinds of pressure on our kids, and I think that parents will perpetuate that. And here's what I mean by that. I think when we were applying to college, you probably applied to 2, 3, maybe 4 schools. And when you did that, you were fairly certain that the schools that you were applying to were pretty safe. You might have had a reach or two. Now, I don't think that that we can be sure of that for our kids. If you take your students on those college tours, what they're going to tell you on those tours is that we now have students who come to us from 71 different countries around the world. And it's wonderful that kids in those college settings are being integrated with kids on that kind of global level. But at the same time, what that means is they are also competing to get into those colleges with kids from all around the world. Much more so, I think, than we did when we were applying to college. So there's greater competition. If I take a look at someone who went to an Ivy League school in 1985, for example, those people will tell you I probably would not get into that school today given my credentials. And we have to be very honest. So I think that we need to educate parents around that, that it has, there's a changing world. I mean, there's a whole different sort of applicant pool out there, and parents need to hear that and they need to know that. I think it's also important that we have our kids who have graduated from Hopkinton High School, and some of them will tell you, I didn't take a single AP course while I went through Hopkinton High School. And you know what? I got into college, and I now have a job, and I am married, and I have 2 children, and I am a perfectly happy person. I don't think that college is even for every single kid. We had a very nice conversation in one of my meetings today where there was a Hopkinton High School student who indicated that she was really thinking about being a hairdresser. That's really what she wanted to do. And we know that people who are electricians and carpenters and hairdressers make very, very good money. They make a good living and they're probably happy people. But what she said was, I don't know what I'm going to do on the day when I am supposed to go to school and everybody is wearing their college acceptance sweatshirt. So I don't think I can be a hairdresser. And I think, although that's anecdotal, it speaks to, I think, the stigma that we place on not going to a 4-year school. We walk around believing, and I think that we're a district that promotes that culture, that a 4-year school is right for everyone. And how do we get our kids to respect each other when they decide not to attend a 4-year school? And how do we get parents to think, it's okay if my child doesn't attend a 4-year school, but the culture in this district is very different from that right now. And I think that, when we ask kids to come to school in their college acceptance sweatshirts, it's not that we're being insensitive, but I do think that at some point we have to recognize the fact that there may be 5 or 10 or 20 of them who really don't have that interest, right? And I even think there's a tacit hierarchy in that group, because there's going to be 5 or 6 kids who are walking around in really top tier Ivy League kind of school sweatshirts, and there'll be others who aren't, right? So hierarchically, it's one of those things where culturally it might be nice in school, but hierarchically it might be distressing to some of our kids, which I think that kind of pressure is, it's inordinate and it might be undue. I think we've just built it up into a place where it has become unhealthy for a lot of kids.
Thank you. I did not have a question, but hearing what Mr. Shepherd asked you in your response, I'm a wellness teacher for the 2 of you that don't know. That intrigued me, and I appreciate hearing you say that, because as a wellness teacher, I have I love that I get the chance to focus on students as a whole. And I do see the pressures that they face when they're coming from other classes and maybe they're not fitting into the typical mold. But that being said, how you see wellness fitting. And I mean, I sat here the other night too, and I hear special ed questions, and I hear about the curriculum and where we're going next. But we have a pretty good thing here, and I'd like to hear more of your thoughts about wellness.
We have a great thing here, and in the realm of wellness, we have just started to go through the review process for our bullying prevention and intervention plan. The state of Massachusetts says that every district has to have one of those, and it has to be reviewed periodically. So Nancy Kavanaugh, who's on the school committee, and I, and Karen Reno, who is our new SML for wellness, are sort of chairing that committee. And we have administrators and parents and students and lots of people who are all sitting around a table. And in that setting, we had conversations about, well, we have this document, but is the document all that important, or is our culture more important? And while we've been charged with revising that, I think that we have to look way beyond just that document. There was one of the students in our group who was exceedingly thoughtful, said, you know, when we talk about bullying, we have, you know, conversations all the time in our wellness program, and, you know, that's not the kind of bullying that you see in Hopkinton. It's not the kind of bullying where we steal a kid's lunch money, right? But he'll say that what we have in Hopkinton is the kind of bullying where it's very subtle and verbal, and it happens again and again, and kids are taught from the time they're in first grade to the time they hit eighth grade, that bullying curriculum about upstander, bystander, right? Are you going to be a bystander and let it happen, or are you going to be an upstander? And our student on that committee said, most of us are bystanders, and we are, because to be an upstander would be sort of that social suicide. So I think that when you ask the question about where do you see wellness fitting in, I think that we need to make a lot of kinds of cultural shifts around. And I was just in another school district, and as I walked through the door, it was a 5-6 school, they had a beautiful glass display case, and inside there was a phrase, kind is the new cool. And I started to wonder about just promoting kindness in so many ways. I think we're judgmental, we're critical, we're all of those things. And, you know, bullying aside, I think that we need to start thinking about, you know, empathy. What does it feel like to be the kid who won't go to a four-year school, or who isn't quite an athlete, or who isn't a raving beauty, or who isn't going to Harvard, or whatever it is. We need to start thinking about how that fits together. And I look at all of the resources we have. So we've got Hopkinton Youth and Family Services. We've got a group of parents in town who really want to start thinking about how do we bring the cultural other into the fold? What does acceptance look like? How does acceptance differ from tolerance? All of those pieces. We've got programs at Hopkins. They're doing Understanding Our Differences. At the middle school, we've got the Power of We. We've got Best Buddies. We've got all of these different things. But I think that if we really want to sort of make progress in terms of changing our culture, we need to bring all those people to the table, have conversations about what kind looks like, and then people can then go out and go back to those places where they work, and they work very effectively, and bring people along. But I think that there's a whole culture, and it has to involve the community. In the Natick public schools, there's actually, outside of the Natick public schools, a parent group, and they've begun something called Spark. It was a grassroots kind of thing. Parents got together, and now it's thriving. I know that in other districts, they use something called STOP. It started in the Sudbury Public Schools probably close to 20 years ago, maybe more than 20 years ago. But those are the kinds of programs that we can examine and then decide if it's right for Hopkinton or not. But I think that it involves school personnel, it involves parents, it involves different town groups, you know, to be able to support these things, and it means that we have to have a lot of dialogue, and it's got to be ongoing. I don't think it can be. Everybody came to this auditorium on a Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, and we heard this great presentation, and everybody went home, because that's kind of a one-hit wonder, right? It needs to be ongoing, and it has to be in our face all the time, and we have to keep talking about what kind looks like.
Sorry. Yeah, thank you.
Yes.
So it is kind of a funny little place, right? So you've got the Hopkinton Center for the Arts. Not a lot of other places have that. And I think you've got this art culture here that has been built up. And I don't know how it was built up, but my guess is, in looking around, that it has happened somewhat organically. Right? You've got this great new cross-country route that's happening, and that, again, is something that has sort of happened organically. And I guess to sort of very simply answer your question, I think what happens is people here have passion for something, and when they do, they make it happen. You know, and that's been pretty remarkable to me. And then you have these relationships that exist between people's passions and the public schools. So we can go to the Hopkinton Center for the Arts and see these fabulous displays that students have done, or go to the Hopkinton Center for the Arts and see, you know, theater. We can see kids, you know, on that new cross-country trail. So there are lots of things that happen here that just don't happen the same way in other places. I'm kind of marvel really at even our admin team, because I think that what they do very well here is they empower students, you know, in ways that I don't necessarily know I've seen happen elsewhere. A very good example for me of that, I was actually a little blown away when I went through my tour today at Hopkins. I was guided by three students, and one of them, you know, if I asked those kids questions about the difference between science writing and ELA writing, they'll say to me, well, this is how it works. And on the other hand, there's a rare opportunity, and I was thinking, this fifth grade boy is more articulate than I am. Like, this is an amazing thing. Like, shame on me, good for him. It was wonderful. And they could tell me everything about the curriculum and about their school and about what was strong about it, and just amazing things that the kids are doing here that I'm not necessarily sure are happening everywhere else. And we do it on a good budget. Just bringing that up. But if you look at our per pupil expenditure, it's not very high for all of the wonderful services our kids are getting per pupil. Oh, it's much broader. I think we're going to have many, many more students. I think we will have students who are in some ways financially disparate from some of the other kids that we have in school. I think that we, as I said, have kids who are arriving with IEPs that are different from some of the IEPs that we have seen in the past. And I just think that in terms of numbers generally, we are going to have way more kids in this school district in the next 10 years. You know, and I have said to Dr. McLeod, and no, I don't mean to say it in a way that is flip, but there is a danger in building an empire, right? When you build programs that are phenomenal and you have results that are phenomenal, people are sort of crawling over rocks and broken glass to get into Hopkinton. One of the school committee members had indicated to me a few months ago that, you know, she was looking to sell the house she's living in now and perhaps move to another house in Hopkinton. But she said, I will go to an open house at noontime on a Sunday, and before I leave that open house, there are multiple offers on the table. They are cash offers, and they are above asking price in all of those situations. So, you know, there is a danger to building something as wonderful as has been built here. Sure, so what every kid is getting in K-1 and 2, they're getting Foundations instruction for phonics. In the event that kids need something more in phonics, they will get more Foundations in grade 3, just words in grade 4. We are doing guided reading in kindergarten to grade 5, and we are kind of monitoring that using the Fountas and Pinnell BAS benchmark assessment system. For kids who need something more, we do intervention with LLI, level literacy instruction. And for writing, we have brought in Leslie Lott, who does that self-regulated strategy development writing, SRSD. The SRSD writing actually goes from kindergarten all the way to the eighth grade. In the middle school, they only use it in social studies and English language arts and science at Hopkins and at the middle school. They do something similar called CER, which stands for Claims, Evidence, and Reasoning. What typically happens is somewhere around grade four, you know, the whole drill, we say kids stop learning to read and start reading to learn. And I'm not necessarily really fond of that kind of phrasing, because I think that once we get to grade four, we have to stop thinking about content area literacy and move to disciplinary literacy. So what does it mean if I want kids to read like a scientist, right? If I'm asking you to read like a scientist, you have to have the vocabulary to be able to access that, so maybe we have to front load that vocabulary. And much of what we know about science reading is that you can't see the phenomena that you are reading about. So I should be reading the prose and looking at the pictures, and reading the prose and looking at the pictures, right? A lot of times, you know how kids are, right? They'll be in the social studies text or the science text, and they get to a graph or a picture or a painting, and they go, yes, because they don't think they have to read that part, when in reality, that might be the most important reading that they actually do in that text. When we ask kids to start writing in science and language arts, you know, in language arts, we would tell them we want them writing in the present tense, active voice, strong verbs. When we get them into science classrooms, we would expect them to be in the passive voice, lots of the verb to be, right? So at some point, we have to transition our kids from just writing generally to writing in domain-specific areas. So I think what's happening right now at the Hopkins School is probably not dissimilar from what happens in many elementary schools. So if you're doing character education and you do things like, what does it mean to have empathy? What does it mean to be respectful? What does it mean to be an upstander? Right, all of those questions. If kids are getting some curriculum around that, and at Hopkins right now they do have Understanding Our Differences, the beauty of that is that kids keep going from classroom to classroom, and the teachers in those classrooms can continue to build on that theme for the entire month that happens to be the theme, right? But I think that when you get to the middle school, one thing that's nice is you have teams, but one thing that I find is that if I'm a middle school teacher, and even if we have something sort of prepackaged, right? We watch this video on Friday mornings, and it lasts for 15 minutes, and you know, it might be some really powerful learning, but teachers will address those things differently depending upon their own comfort levels, right? So if I am a person who is not shy about talking about race or ethnicity or gender or sexuality or those kinds of things, I may feel comfortable having conversations with kids about that. But if I'm not one of those people, I'll just press play and kind of let it go at that. Right. So I think that there's a huge thing about building teacher capacity around this and getting teachers comfortable. I can remember being in a classroom where I was working with beginning teachers, and we were talking about that whole thing about building safe culture in classrooms. And a teacher in a neighboring district had said to me, I had a terrible thing happen to me today. I had a little boy ask me why that girl had weird hair. And, you know, she's an African-American student. I didn't know what to say. Right, but I think that comes from just plain old ordinary fear about talking about the differences in, you know, black people hair and white people hair, right? So there is that whole need, I think, to educate teachers to raise their comfort levels. And then I think that if we're looking at, you know, high school, it's hard to build in that kind of time. And so I think we have to look at, well, what do we value? Right, because I do agree with you, it is happening in pockets. We can be in a social studies classroom and have wonderful conversations that, get close to things like culture and social emotional learning. And you can be in an English classroom and have that. But if the English teacher and the social studies teacher have no time to have conversations about those things, there's probably no carryover. And I do think there's almost a redundancy, because I think in wellness and in special education and in the guidance office and in classrooms, all of those things are happening. I think it's just a matter of getting people together and talking about what's important. And I don't know if people think about going to, you know, monthly themes or advisory or other places where you could say, this is really, you know, the heart of what we're doing for the entire freshman year. It's our theme. This is what we do sophomore year. There are lots of different ways to approach it, but I think that it does need to be approached, right? I mean, it will be, it make us all a lot more effective. We're not ineffective, but we could be more effective pooling our resources, efforts, and thinking. Challenge. And I think to be a successful superintendent, you have to establish those relationships. And geographically in this town, we are sort of challenged. You can go to other communities where there's a town hall, and you'll see that the highway department's here, and the school department's here, and the town manager is there. And then, you know, as a part of that building, there's also a police station over there, and the fire station is two doors down. So what happens in those settings is that you come to work on Monday morning, how was your weekend, everybody sort of jibber-jabbers. If I have a question for the highway department, I walk two doors down and I ask the question. Here you have to work very hard to create those relationships, right, because we're all in very different places. But I think about that and I think, all right, so it's December, it will not be long before there's, you know, an impending blizzard, and there has to be ongoing communication between the police department and the highway department. So establishing those relationships and establishing the kind of respect and trust is really important. We can't have situations where I don't get back to you until, you know, 4 o'clock in the morning to let you know that I really don't think the roads are very safe, right? So I think that there has to be that kind of ongoing conversation all night long. When we just had the recent, you know, rain, wind, tree down kind of storm, we were, as I described, scrambling in central office trying to reroute buses and make sure that students were going to be safe and make sure that we didn't have kids walking under down power lines. And as we were doing that, more power lines and more trees were coming down. So if I'm Steve Slayman, I'm going to be working assiduously with my team to kind of follow that and get in touch with NSTAR and do all of that. But there has to be time that he agrees to make for the schools. We have 3,500 kids coming to school and leaving school every day. It doesn't matter if they're on a big yellow bus or in their mom's car. We have to make sure that those kids are safe from the time they step foot in the bus to the time they get off of that bus. So those relationships are really important. I mean, I can remember even, you know, last year when we knew we had voting here at the middle school, just the need to make sure that we had, you know, police available to us so that we wouldn't have people walking in to vote and then walking around our building, right? So I think that that political piece is important. I will be a person who reaches out all of the time to other town departments, and it might even make sense for us to have sort of monthly meetings where we just get together and kind of catch up and have conversations that are important. To all of you for coming out. It's December, it's cold, it's a busy time of year, so I appreciate your commitment. Thank you.